this evening, we have a young man by the name of Madison Gibson. He's from Lawndale Elementary, and he's going to give us our pledge. But before he comes up, let me read a few things about Madison. Mason, I'm always getting these names incorrect every meeting. Mason Gibson is an 8-year-old third grade A honor roll student at Lawndale Elementary. Mason is a model student who embodies the attributes of honesty and determination. Mason's favorite subject is math because it is a challenging subject that he does well in, and he loves to challenge himself. He is also an avid reader, and his favorite books are the Diary of a Wimpy Kids series. Outside of school, one of Mason's favorite things to do is to play football. Since he was 4, he has been a member of the Pop Warner team, the Akron Titans, and this year they won the regional title. Mason also likes to play video games, and his favorites are Lego Dimensions, WWE, and most other Lego video games. Mason would most likely like to attend the Ohio State University, but he is undecided at this time. Ultimately, though, Mason would like to be a professional wrestler. At this time, let's have Mason come up and do our Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before Mason sits down, we're going to do a photo op and hopefully I won't mess it up. First of all, I think Mason... Patrick said he might have outdressed me today. He got a seersucker and I can't afford it. So he's doing good. All right, Mason, who do you have with you this evening?
My mom, Marty Gibson, and my two siblings, Demar and Demai Gibson.
Great. All right. Okay, and so since Mason wants to go to the Ohio State University, maybe, and he wants to possibly be a WWE wrestler. We're going to allow him to go and get his homework done first so he can work on his wrestling moves. Oh, spring break. That's enough. He's going to go home and practice those moves. Don't do it on your brother, though. Okay?
Oh, we do it on
time. Okay. If you don't want to stay, you don't have to. If you want to, you can feel free to stay, okay? All right, thank you again, Mason.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Okay, thank you.
Break to be good.
Yeah, that's pretty special. I know. Okay, community reflections. Patrick.
I'll just throw out a couple. I had an opportunity to be at the Reach Opportunity Center recently to be on a panel discussion, but it was focused on the Reach Opportunity Center. And it's nice to get out there once in a while and see what's going on and see our presence out there and see the rooms with the kids in them. So just a brief mention for that. I also participated in the Our City, Our Ward program. It was held at Buchtel High School, and it was put on by Ward 4, Akron Ward 4 City Council person Russ Neal. It was a really good opportunity. He brought together several representatives from government and nonprofit and the schools to talk about what strategies were being used or were sort of happening in Ward 4 to make a difference in the neighborhoods there. So we got to speak a little bit about what's going on at Akron Public Schools. The questions that I received actually focused on career tech, which was appropriate given the strong presence of career tech in Buchtel and the outstanding programs that we have in masonry and in food service and some of the others. And so we talked a little bit about that. But surprisingly, those were the questions that I got about career tech, which is something else to, I guess, just think about is just It's surprising to me sometimes and a little sobering that people don't always know what we have and sort of the hidden gems that we have at some of our schools in terms of programming. I know board member Tim Miller has been big on career tech and the linkage between participating in career tech and graduation rates. So I think it was fitting that someone asked those questions and we could point right to the building we were standing in and talk about the programs we have there. We had our finance committee meeting on the 21st, which I know Tim and I are going to report out on shortly. I attended the volunteer appreciation banquet with several board members here, and it was a great event. Superintendent James, as always, did a fantastic job representing the district, and I thought the speech that you gave and the comments that you gave were really well done for the people that have given so much to the district and to our kids. So thanks for doing that. That was really special. And just had an opportunity to be present at the STEM meeting for prospective parents, and holy cow. I mean, those kids, the schedules, and the things that go on in that building, just phenomenal. So I'll leave it there.
Well, I'll piggyback off of what Patrick said in terms of the career prep, because I had two opportunities last week to take advantage of our culinary. We were lucky enough to have the Kenmore Group prepare a meal for our board retreat, which was fabulous, and they did an excellent job, so they should be commended for that. And then the next day, I went to the Garfield Easter Buffet, which was equally as wonderful, and so I should not eat for the rest of my life. But I just want to say that both of those programs and the students in them are doing just a fabulous job and learning a lot.
And one of them going to the Culinary Institute.
One of them going to the Culinary Institute. It's just amazing. So big kudos to that part of the career tech program. I also attended the APS Volunteer Appreciation Night, and that was excellent. We had lots of great people. And then I just want to wish everybody, even though it's belated, I hope everybody had a happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
Mr. Miller. A couple different things. We had a business advisory council meeting, and superintendent was nice enough to let me present to the business community about what I saw and heard and learned when I was down in Nashville studying the academies. And specifically, I talked about getting the business community involved, and had a very nice discussion, I thought, on that subject, on that topic. So that was a good meeting. The Business Advisory Council. I was honored to go and not necessarily participate, but just watch at Findlay last Wednesday as they gave out backpacks to the students. And I guess they do it Wednesday just in case a student misses and comes on Thursday, and then they make sure that the student gets the backpack and food for the spring break to take home with them. So, and every kid in that building gets it. You know, regardless of need, though there's a lot of need in that building, so that was nice. Also, the volunteer appreciation dinner banquet I attended, I was honored to be able to give awards to different community members and organizations. And one in particular that I also got to accept was the one for Weather Vane Theater, which I brought here, so I thought I'd give it to Mrs. Mansfield so she could take it and share it with everybody at Weather Vane. But it was very nice what Weather Vane does for Project Rise, and that's why they were nominated and given the award. They let many of the people from Project Rise, I guess I'll let you take a look at it and pass it around and give it to Lisa. A discussion I had about that, it's a break from reality for some of the homeless that attend our schools and families in the community, that Weather Vane gives free tickets for people to go there and just go let their imagination run wild and get away from their daily grind and think about something positive. So, as always, that's always a very nice banquet.
Thank you very much. Topping off of what, commenting on what Mr. Miller had said, the it is important that those students have that opportunity to see that sort of thing, that it does exist, it is real, and it is within their reach, you know, should they decide to head in that direction. And and again, thank you for bringing it up, but I would something years ago that I was at that I didn't realize, I was naive enough to believe that things were different, and I got to see the situation, and it really it made me, for the rest of my political career, made me think about that, what you were just talking about. So thank you.
Ms. Mansfield.
Well, I feel spoiled rotten for the things I've gotten to do in the last couple of weeks, arts wise. I swear it's not all I do, but I knew so many of the kids that have been in these programs that it's just been an honor to go and watch them represent our district. I did get to attend Once Upon This Island. It was it's the first year that Alex Funk has been the director over at Miller South, and he did a fantastic job. It was a great show. It's always fantastic to see a good production. It's 10 times better when you get to see kids who you know are having a good time. And because they were having such a good time, you couldn't help but smile and have a good time with them. And they did a fantastic job over there. There were students of all ages in that one. And it's not a show that often gets produced. And so it was nice to see, other than at schools. And so it was nice to see it get produced there. It was great. Then, as a departure from that, I went to the Akron Symphony, where Christopher Wilkins had wonderful things to say about the arts in Akron Public Schools. I wish I would have had a recording of all of the wonderful things he said about us, Mr. James. He couldn't have been nicer. The reason that he has so many nice things to say is because the symphonic choir from Firestone, along with, I believe there were 8 soloists, and I apologize to the board. I grabbed programs. They gave me programs to bring to all of you. I will bring them to the next meeting. I have post-Easter egg something, I don't know, that I left them all sitting on my counter. So they're lovely, and they talk about all of our of the collaboration. But there were 8 soloists who brought the house down with their talents, and did credit not only to their school, to the district, but also to their private teachers who we bring into the school and have them have work with them as well through the Akron School of the Arts. So it was a breathtaking evening, and to get to perform on the E.J. Thomas stage with a full orchestra behind you when you were 15, 16, 17, 18 years old, what a memorable experience that'll be for them for probably the rest of their lives. And their parents, because their parents were us. They were all in tears and just loving every minute of it. And then this past weekend was multiple sold-out performances of The Little Mermaid at Firestone High School. I don't know that the only show they might not have sold out was Wednesday night. And I don't know what that auditorium holds, but it was packed to the rafters. And I can tell you that I heard tell of Saturday afternoon being full of many 3, 4, 5-year-olds in full princess regalia with flashy wands and sparkly feet as well, who just could not wait to see Ariel. And again, credit to Mr. Zimmerman for his direction, Marissa Leonards for her choreography, but to our students for their gracious time after their performance. They're exhausted. They've just, you know, especially on Saturday, they did 2 shows. They've done all these shows in a row. They stayed and talked to every little child that wanted to meet Ariel or Flounder or whoever they were. And we're talking about, you know, 15, 16-year-old kids who probably have got a cast party coming and something great. I watched Ariel, who's Kate Klicka, be taught how to sign her name by a child with disabilities. She taught her how to sign Ariel, and she wouldn't let her go until she signed it back to her. And Kate took all the time to learn how to sign with her, and I know that Kate got as much out of it as the young lady did. I know I did watching her. So what a credit to them and to the district as well, that they took all that time with those young people and encouraged them, and who knows what difference that eventually makes in their lives. So
they
good job.
A couple of spots in the Beacon Journal.
Yeah, they did. It was great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, the only thing I wanted to add is to encourage our wonderful volunteerism. The banquet highlighted different segments where individuals can volunteer, and they were given those lovely awards that the Weather Vane received, and we just want to encourage them, especially a group of young people from Akron U. They work with Helen Arnold, CLC, and it was about maybe four or five of them, and they collaborated with fraternities, sororities, civic groups, and at the university to make sure every student, everybody had something for Christmas, a gift, a coat. This group, I think their title is Hope Something, but they are an excellent group. I thought it was a much older group of people who were a little foundation, but these are juniors and seniors who have dedicated themselves to giving back to an urban district to encourage the students at Helen Arnold, and they were excited about their volunteerism. So we're grateful and want to not only applaud them, but a host of others, like Weather Vane, especially those, there may have been three, that were given awards because they helped Project Rise. Right. They took it on their part to work with our homeless population. So again, we want to salute those who volunteer in a mighty way to support our public school students.
And three of those students from Hope are in education.
Right.
So it was nice to see that they're in education and they're putting some time in now before they get into their teaching experience. I want to give my community events, and I just have two that I want. Everything has been elaborated on. I have two that I want to just specifically talk about. First is King Elementary. I had the opportunity to be asked to come to King Elementary to talk to the fifth graders who are getting ready to go into middle school. And it was fun. The kids were very active, very involved, but they wanted me to talk about transition from elementary to middle. And it was good information that they received, good feedback that I received. One of the things that really made me happy is I received an email from each one of those students who were there on what they learned that day. And I have to print it out, but it's each one of them sent what they learned that day. And that was really, really good. The teachers are excellent. It was just a good program. And I think those kids are gonna do really well because they're really intelligent. Some of the comments that they gave to me, you would never thought the fifth graders would send comments like that. So they're on their way. So I went there, but the other one was Finley Elementary, which is an outstanding event that I went to on last Thursday. Mr. Miller went on Wednesday. I went on Thursday, and it was called Lunch on a Blanket. And the parents were allowed to come in that day and have lunch on a blanket with their kids in the gymnasium, as well as in the cafeteria. And it was such a nice event to see the multitude of ethnic groups and the way that they related the interaction, and for those kids who maybe parents were not able to attend, how someone pulled them and said, come and eat with us. It was just an amazing, amazing event. Reverend Walker went last year and he talked about it, but I think I would ask every board member, if you ever get a chance, to please go up to Philly. The different dialects they have, the different nationalities they have, I mean, the volunteers that they have there, it's just amazing. And I felt so bad because there was one little young lady, she was crying so hard, and she really didn't speak much English, and I was trying to communicate, and I was saying, why was she crying, and I didn't understand, but the interpreter told me that she was crying because her parents were not able to make it there, and I thought that was so sad, and I wanted to just hug her and hold on to her, because it's very important for parents to be involved with their kids' education. I think sometimes we don't see how important that is to the kids and how very, very important it is for those kids to have the parents in their lives. You can see the joy of those kids eating lunch, you know, with their parents or a relative from the family. And so it was really, really great. So I encourage all of us to, if you get a chance to go to Finley and just look at that. I mean, you're going to be amazed, really, really amazed. Okay, with saying that, next is communication and recognitions, and we have a presentation, school-based health clinic from North High School by the Summit County Public Health Department and the International Community Health Center. So please come forward and give us your presentation.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. I'm Leanne Beavers from Summit County Public Health. I'm the Clinic Health Director of Services. And I wanted to say that in the beginning when administration and I went down to Columbus and we started looking at what school-based health was and would it be good to bring it into our county, we thought of North immediately because the health department's been quite involved with North over the last couple school years with tuberculosis and communicable disease and so forth going in there. And we all know that that's a large refugee population in North Hill, and it comes with a lot of cultural sensitive issues and so forth, which led us to believe probably the first people that we wanted to come into conversation was Asia Inc. for the cultural sensitivity, and we're a refugee resettlement clinic at the health department, and so is Asia Inc., a refugee resettlement. So with that being said, we're going to kind of go into a little bit of a PowerPoint here of what school-based health is. And so for a little cartoon for you, we see a kid here who has hunger, sickness, homelessness, and could someone please help me with these? I'm late for my math class. So educational success starts with healthy learners, and students who complete high school are more likely to have a lifetime of better health and economic opportunities. School-based health care gives elementary, middle school, and high school students access to health and wellness in the place where they spend the most time, which is school.
So we wanted to talk a little bit about what school-based health centers are doing. So school-based health centers boost educational success, and that's been noted throughout the years of school-based health centers existing. They've been around about 30 years with some history. I first was introduced to school-based health when I received my degree at Catholic University, which was in DC, and they have a large amount of school-based health centers in the Washington, DC area, Baltimore, and New York City. And they've traditionally been very influential in assisting immigrant, refugee, and underserved students to achieve health and wellness and thus help them within the schools. So as we're saying here, keeping students healthy and ready to learn and reducing social barriers to educational success that may occur due to their health concerns and medical access issues. This is me again. You can't see. So just like here, basically this slide is like just describing what exactly school-based health centers are. So basically school-based health centers are bringing the actual center or health center to the students within their environment, which is their school. So they would be just like your regular pediatric and family practice office. They are staffed by a nurse practitioner or a physician. They often have nurses and also medical assistants and a receptionist. There's 27 of them in Ohio, and there's 1,900 of them within the country.
School-based health centers, research has shown that school-based health centers improve school attendance, improve the rate of graduation, decrease emergency room and urgent care visits, decrease hospitalizations for children with asthma, improve access to and use of mental health services, and improve access and use of preventative services, and improve vaccination rates. School-based health centers reduce Medicaid expenditure related to inpatient drug and emergency department use. The needs assessment for North High School, The demographics, as I know this group is very well aware, but it's 40% Asian, 31% African American, 21% Caucasian, 4% Hispanic, and 4% multiracial. Poverty, 100% of the students meet the definition of being economically disadvantaged, 80% are Medicaid eligible, and the poverty rate among the student body is 26%. Absentee for chronic was 22%. Graduation rates, only 69% of ninth grade graduates in 4 years. There is a 36% gap in the graduation rates between Caucasian, African American students and their Asian counterparts. Social indicators, high number of students from first generation immigrant families. Behavior risk factors, North High School students have multiple identified health risks based on the most recent Summit County High School Health Risk Behavior Survey, including early sexual activity, smoking, alcohol, substance use, depression, and being overweight. Our partners. In this slide, we'd like to show that Summit County Public Health would be the community convener. We do the technical assistance, wraparound services. Akron Public Schools would be our host, provide the space. Asia International Community Health Center would be the medical sponsor, would provide the nurse practitioner, physician, etc. This is a diagram showing the structure. So over here on your left, you see the school board. They provide the space, the facility for the nurse, utilities, phone, janitorial services, etc. The HQFQ, which is Asia Inc., is going to provide the nurse practitioner, MD, the primary care provider, the medical supplies, pharmaceuticals, hazardous waste, etc. And then over to the right, the Board of Health coordinates the community advisory committee. We provide chronic disease management, perhaps dental services, substance abuse counseling, and help with the grant writing.
Okay, so again, my name's Brandy Dobbs, and I am one of the family nurse practitioners at International Community Health Center. I want to explain a little bit about Asia International Community Health Center, because it's a lot of words there. So Asia is the organization that is like the larger organization, and then basically the big umbrella. And then underneath Asia, there's multiple services. So Asia stands for Asian Services in Action. They're based both in Akron and as well in Cleveland. I am in the Cleveland branch right now. We are opening an Akron branch of our clinic, International Community Health Center. However, we have social services in both areas, in both Cleveland and in both Akron. So when you hear me speak of Asia and ICHC, I may refer to it as ICHC, which is International Community Health Center, instead of just going through the whole words. So we would be the medical sponsor. We do have experience working with refugees as well as immigrants. The organization itself was founded by women that were of Chinese descent, and they were founded to assist immigrants that were traveling a very far distance from Cleveland, usually to New York City, to get access, medical access, with healthcare providers that could understand them and understand their language. And so that's really how the entire organization took off. So we have in our background an extensive amount of history working with immigrants and being invested in their communities. As far as our goals for the school-based health center, just like the national goals, we would want to improve access to medical, dental, and mental health services. We would desire to provide comprehensive and holistic health care for children and adolescents. Improve academic achievement by addressing health concerns, health risks, and by providing routine health screenings. Address and improve health disparities within the underserved pediatric and adolescent population, and to develop students into becoming their own health advocates for themselves and others regarding their health. The services that we would offer would be pretty much identical to the services that we would be offering any of the patients at our clinics. Although at the school-based health center, we would be centered around student health. Student health, and then potentially eventually looking at the health of some siblings. As far as adults, the parents, we would most likely refer them to the clinic. So we would be very much student focused. So we would provide diagnostics or referrals for diagnostics, treatment of acute illness, diagnosis of acute illness, We would do medical management of chronic health issues, for example, asthma, any type of diabetes, morbid obesity, anything that you would find in clinical practice. Comprehensive well-child's exams, which is just your complete physicals for children, which also looks at their development. Looking at adolescent exams, looking at the GAPS exams, identifying what those risks are for those students. Sports physicals, as I said, management of chronic medical conditions, looking at immunizations and vaccines and being able to administer those. Laboratory tests, any type of reproductive health or screening. Referrals and coordination, we would attempt to make these relationships with partners if we had a situation where we needed an x-ray or to refer a child out, which is what we do in basic practice. Many times there's a lot of questions between the school, what is the school nurse's responsibility, and what is the responsibility of the school-based health center, and so that's just an ongoing question. As far as the school-based health center is not there to replace the school nurse. We're there to become partners and have a relationship with the school health nurses. We're there to help them extend the services that they need. Many times nurses, I was a nurse before, I was a nurse practitioner, and you're limited at times by your license and what you can do as far as management of students. And so I really look at it in that way. If I was a nurse, I would want to have a physician or a nurse practitioner or a physician assistant. If I find a problem, that can manage the problem. It's not in my scope of practice as a nurse to be managing or prescribing medications. So that's really what we are going to be doing within the school. We're going to be working together, not competing, but working together. So school nurse, just briefly, employed by the school district, manage a student immunization program, coordinate screenings, chronic school health case management, manages chronic medication delivery during the school day, oversees school health programs. As far as a school-based health center, we would be providing a provider, which takes it further. In this situation, would be employed by an FQHC, which is Asia. We would be able to work with a school nurse regarding ordering those immunizations, administering those immunizations. We would be able to also provide them with assistance to understand the recommendations of the immunizations and follow up with those immunizations with providing well-child exams. We would be conducting screenings and physicals, management of medications, any type of tests that need to be ordered with any type of chronic illness, and then counseling, prevention, and wellness promotion, such as looking at the risk of that particular school and developing programs for the students there.
And this is a very important factor because with schools, the immunization is what the kids need, and as they go to 12th grade, 7th grade, so forth, is always changing. And so a school nurse knows what they need and tracks it, but they have the ability to give that immunization. Now that would give the responsibility and the advantage of being able to give that to meet those demands.
So sorry that this is so small, but initially, this is looking at a timeline of staffing. So initially, we would be coming in, the nurse practitioner and myself would be coming in within the first semester for 4 hours per week. And then we would think to increase it to an entire day, and then we would increase it as we found the need for services. This slide is related to the location and the hours. So we would be utilizing a vacant office space within North High School. Again, initially the center would be open 48 hours per week while the school is in session. As the volume of the patients increases, these hours would be expanded based on the need that's being expressed by the community. The school-based health center will not be open during holidays or summers initially unless there is a demonstrated need. There may be thought to opening hours within the summer in the future for preparation for school and the immunizations that are needed for those and also the physical exams. Schedules would be posted widely and distributed to familiarize students and families with the services that we provide. Regarding confidentiality, consent, and enrollment, again, we would abide by what we would do in clinical practice, which is by HIPAA, in addition to that, FERPA. The process in order to be part of the school-based health center is we need to have a consent by parents, giving us permission to see their children with and without them. Consent forms will be provided in the school health center enrollment packet, and once signed will become a part of the child's medical record. The consent form will cover the duration of the current school year, unless otherwise specified, unless we extend that in the future. Regarding compensation payment and billing, so we at our clinic use an EMR system in order to bill. We would be billing the same way we would bill in any FQHC or clinic. We would be using Medicaid, we'd be using Medicare, we also accept private insurance. In some instances, there is an inability for some students to qualify within all three of those categories that I just mentioned. We have sliding scales for families that do not have private insurance or do not qualify for Medicare or Medicaid. And in the case where none of the above applies, we will never turn a student away and have them not receive medical access because they can't pay. Regarding billing, we would always speak to the parent. We would never speak to specifically to the student. Evaluation. Again, we at International Community Health Center have electronic health records, and practice management system would be used to collect and store patient encounter data, as we do currently at our clinic. And we would, as I said before, use this for billing process. In addition, we would be looking at satisfaction surveys of the students, of the parents that are utilizing the clinic, as well as teachers. Data, billing information, survey results will be utilized in the future to evaluate and monitor the progress and set goals for the school-based health project.
That's
a question
related.
Oh, it's questions.
Okay. The PHI, all those protective health information.
Right.
You're responsible for that. Do you keep and maintain that?
Right.
Your EMR, is that tied directly externally to your own system?
What we would use is the electronic medical record that we have currently at all of our clinics, which is Epic. And so Epic is used by Cleveland Clinic, Epic is used by Metro.
It's usually
used within the U.S. And so we would be collecting all of that data, any of that health information, PHI information you mentioned, would be in the EMR system.
If you can define nurse practitioner, and then also you mentioned the other
physician's assistants? Okay, so right now we don't have any physician's assistants at our organization. Nurse practitioners, basically, we have both a nursing degree as well as a master's degree in a specific area of nurse practitioner. So like, for instance, I'm a family nurse practitioner. The entire approach and model of Asia is family practice model. Family practice means that we see anywhere from newborn all the way to 100. And we're certified in management of care of all of those patients.
From birth to death,
all the way through. Regarding physician's assistants, there's not much difference between an NP and a physician's assistant. The main difference between those two is when we're ordering medications and signing medications, NPs do not need to have, a nurse practitioner doesn't need to have a co-sign for those. Whereas with a physician assistant, the physicians are supposed to look back in their records and co-sign their medications that they're prescribing. But both of us, physician assistant and nurse practitioners, have our own panel of patients. We have our own licenses, and we do the plan and entire management of all of our patients' health care. So right now at the organization, in the Cleveland office and in the 2B Akron office, we actually have three nurse practitioners. We're all family nurse practitioners. Actually, two of us are family nurse practitioners. One of us is a gerontological nurse practitioner. Our medical director is family practice, and we all speak different languages. So between all of us is Arabic, Mandarin, some Cantonese, Spanish, and I think Portuguese.
And your second language?
Is Spanish.
Okay. Now, there's always an issue. I noted on your services that you provide. You provide reproductive services. Mm-hmm. And so what area of reproductive
services family practice would provide. So in general, with any family practice and any pediatric practice, mm-hmm. when you're a provider, basically it really depends on your patient. What does that involve? If you have a patient that's at higher risk for any type of sexual situation, you need to screen for that. You have to do that for your patient. If there's information and if you find that there's a risk factor or that particular patient is at risk or desires information from you regarding different types of contraceptives, you give them that information. And that's what your responsibility is.
Do you give the information or you give the contraceptive?
We give the information.
So you provide a prescription?
We can provide prescriptions for them if it's needed or asked for.
Okay. And that's with or without the permission of the parent?
In Ohio and in every state, you can do that without permission of parents. Because they're legal, right? As well as having the legal right to screen for any type of sexually transmitted disease. So it's no different. It's, and as I was explaining as we were doing this, really the same thing happens in a pediatric office, family practice office. It's the same way I would practice if I was in a family practice office. It's the same way I would practice as I would be in a school-based health center.
Yes, ma'am. The nurse practitioner thing, I was in Columbus at the time that they passed that, that allowed the practitioners to prescribe certain levels without the doctor. You were oversaw by a doctor, but you had the latitude to make the decision on your own, which I thought was a great idea. The question that I have is the billing. Okay, now most of these folks, this is the only thing that concerns me, and maybe I missed it on your thing, but you said the billing on a sliding scale. I would say 99% of these folks aren't going to have the capability to pay, or we're not going to be sending them out.
Bills
and collection services and all this. I mean,
so the majority of the time, the majority of the patients that are at North, actually North High School really resembles a lot of the patients I've seen in practice in FQHCs historically. The majority of those patients are Medicaid patients. So we would bill with Medicaid if it was CareSource, Buckeye, whatever the Medicaid is. Situations where we have sliding scales normally arise when the patients do not have insurance. And with the sliding scale, what we would do is we would work with them based on the government standards of how much they need to pay based on their family income. And that all depends on the number of people that's in their household and the number of people that are working in their household. Sometimes they don't have to pay anything if they provide their certain documentation to support the amount of money that they make per year. The situations that arise, like for instance, when you have people that are illegal, for instance, when I was working in Washington, D.C., it was a different situation, or in California, sometimes you have patients that come in and they don't have that information for you. They can't give that information. They're not employed. They're being paid, under the table at times. And so those are the situations that are a little different where they actually don't apply to have the sliding scale. And that's where I was saying that we would not allow a child in that situation to not be seen because they do not fit into those different categories.
But this is what I'm getting at. And I understand what you're saying. You did a very good job explaining that. I've seen a situation where the kid is sick, mm-hmm. needs to see a nurse practitioner or a doctor. The parent is just above that threshold, but that money is not able to be allocated towards that. It needs to be allocated towards other things, food, clothes. And that's my only concern is that if they're above that threshold, say they have Aetna, okay, they're not medicated, but barely above it, we're not going to go after them and continue to build them and turn them
over
to
collection. Our intent is not to send any of our patients.
Well, it's always the opposite intent not to do it. Are we going to do it or not do it?
We're not going to send the patients to collections. We work with patients all the time about how much they can pay and working with them to, if they're going to pay us a small amount, working with those families in receiving that small amount of what they can afford.
Because some of these kids are chastised by their parents. Yeah, I went and saw the doctor. Well, you shouldn't have did that. We can't afford that. You're just going to have to suffer and stick it out, you know.
Right.
I mean, it does happen. And, okay, thank you.
One of the, on one of the early parts of the slide where you had listed the responsibilities, APS, about one of the things for APS was legal services, and I'm just curious what you thought that involved and what could be the ramifications of legal services.
I think that's in the model. There we go. Yeah, finding it.
It was an early slide. I know.
I just wanted to add something. I'm sorry. I just wanted to respond to John, your comment about the idea around health department's there because we're going to provide a lot of these wraparound services. So families that are struggling, much like you do in public health right now, we will find ways to provide services to those families without they're going without food, without anything else happening, which is what we do every day. We will do everything we can to get Medicaid, get reimbursement, compensation, whatever we can. So, and that's why there's this partnership's important.
Right.
So that we don't have, and if it's dental bills and the kids need filling and they don't have any money, we're not going to let that kid go.
Yeah, I mean, it's what kills me is, I'm going to use my son for example because he has a heart condition. He has to have two MRIs with special software, $18,000. Yeah. Insurance pays $17,500. Right. But man, they are coming after you with the next day for the $500. Yes. You're going to pay it right now? Or, you know, no, I'm not paying it. You're getting $17,500. That's what you're getting. And
but we don't operate like that.
That's what I'm saying. And some of these immigrants, they have a proud heritage. They come over here. They just want an opportunity to start, and then we're throwing them into the wolves with the collection agency. And I just didn't want us to be getting into that. Maybe develop some kind of policy not to do that. Yes. Okay, thank you very much.
Yes, and I see we have utilities, phone, internet, janitorial, maintenance, security, and legal services. I think what that is just overall putting this all together and what the implications and so forth are. I don't think there was input of legal representation.
The MOUs
right.
And
correct.
And then you have school psychologists, I believe, also we're to provide that person.
Exactly.
Okay.
Speaking of, I guess I just wanted to. So I notice on some of your indicators, you under behavioral, you did have depression. So from at least a healthcare standpoint or healthcare integration standpoint, there will be that close tying with mental health services, preferably for something like trauma-informed care with some recognizing that these are refugee immigrant status and that
right,
will be part
right.
of the whole clinic focus.
We actually have, the other great part about working with us being part of Asia is we have that in our social services. We already work with refugee youth within the schools. We have a youth and family services department. We have a department for voter registration, citizenship. We have a department for women that are in domestic violence situations. We have social workers that work with us within that, with women that are going through abuse and assisting them in that process. We also are developing our mental health department right now. And our psychologist who's coming on, she has an extensive history with children and youth. And we also work and consult with Metro Health in Cleveland with their psychiatry department. And I would need to learn more in Akron about where we refer kids that are having a suicidal kind of, that kind of approach, that would not, you have that presentation. But when I worked at, I also worked in Cleveland in the school-based health centers at a different organization. We were able to make those connections with Metro Health if we had a child that was coming in that was suicidal and referring them immediately for assistance. So that's definitely one of our goals, is to address a lot of the depression, much of the depression and anxiety that's seen within adolescents and children, and a lot of times is not really managed well from a medical standpoint.
Part of our goal, or long-term goal at North, is to look at that as a possible medical corridor, mm-hmm. which you would fit into that
another reason why
profile. Mm-hmm. When we went to Nashville, Mr. Miller and I and Sister Williams and
Barbara Williams and others, you had students in the building who were learning, for instance, how to deliver a baby, how to look at ultrasound, how to provide services. In your thinking long term, if we had such, would that be able to fit into this clinic as a training or internship or shadowing possibility? How would that work into the whole scheme?
We would have to look at that. We have to also make sure that we provide the confidentiality of students who are in there with the student who wants to learn.
Correct.
So that is definitely something that we knew that was on the horizon. We could see what we could incorporate. Definitely we possibly do blood pressure and simplistic things. But it would be a lot of looking and gathering and so forth before we could just, we don't want Mary to.
That's what I said, long term, not exactly. Something that's going to happen
exactly
right away.
That definitely was on the horizon.
We're all taking our steps.
And get experience.
But at least you would have some knowledge. That's something that we're.
And the other thing we thought is if we couldn't give that direct service right there, if we take them to their local office, which is right down on Market Street, they could get that experience right on Market Street.
Without
confidentiality
issues.
So that definitely was on.
It would be difficult for that to occur, for them to be in a visit with me. While we do that many times for medical students and for nursing students, it would be compromising to do that in the school-based health center, but not so much as you're saying if they were to go to the clinic that's associated with us, the school-based health center.
I know Donna SCOTUS here, so, and I know that where we see Donna, I know that she will be good on outcomes and like kind of what happens from all of this, right? So what does it look like on the end? And I assume we have a counterpart within APS that will kind of look at some of those expected outcomes. So under goals, you had specifically mentioned some things including academic achievement, and you mentioned graduation rate and attendance rate. And so are we prepared from the academic standpoint of this to start measuring the outcomes, and do we know what our expected outcomes are? Are we sort of putting all that together?
Yeah, I think we're putting all that together. And I also think that as we coordinate the community advisory committee, that is the kind of things we'll be looking at. What are those goals and what are our expectations and our measurements?
I was reminded by Mr. Miller, we have right now an existing LPN program that has been in existence for years. Would that be an area of training ground or shadowing or some other internship that could be provided to our existing LPN program?
Now remember, as part of the LPN program, they have their clinicals that they have to do already. And don't forget, we also have our dental assisting program at Central Howard, which we need to move, and they have clinicals, and they actually treat some of our students in terms of the dental exams, and we have a lot of different partners that we're working with. So this is just part of that puzzle, but we have the potential for lots of other partnerships in those healthcare areas. As Barbara Williams can attest to.
We'd like North to be the pilot, the start. You know, we also would like to look, and it could be different partners that we'd look at with different high schools, whether it would be Bookdole, Kenmore, Barberton, et cetera. You know, it could be another HQFQ that co-partners off of that. We thought that Asia was a good fit for this particular pilot program due to the demographics.
I didn't mention that we also have in our organization what makes our clinic so unique and so accessible for immigrants and refugees is we have community health workers in our model. And what community health workers do is amazing for us as providers. They are actually from the community. Many of them that I work with are from the Bhutanese community. They are also certified medical interpreters, so they will be in the room with me. Makes a huge difference versus calling the interpreter line. We also have access if they're not available. We use a phone line and we can call and ask for any language in the world that's spoken. And that's how I'm able to speak to my patients. But having the community health workers that help us with navigation, help us link our patients to wraparound services, they know the community, they know the needs of the community as well, is very, very different approach and very amazingly, it's just very useful.
Huge difference.
And they're medically certified versus the Akron Public Schools, you know, interpreters that they have. They're great interpreters, but they might not be medically certified.
And so we have a number of them that work in our organization, and we would look for one to work specifically with the school-based health program. But in addition to that, if we needed follow-up, we could have a number of the community health workers call parents, obtain consents, explain consents in a way that the parents would understand, which is important for them to understand what they're signing their name to legally. Assist them with signing those consents, the registration forms that are very lengthy. So they're a key part to what we do at our clinic at ICHC.
Superintendent James, are we getting any pushback from the Dental Association on... I know.
No, we have a great partnership with the Dental Association because, again, our students actually get internships with many of the local dental providers. And last year at Leggett, and I forget what program that was, but we had a lot of the dental providers actually come into Leggett along with some of our students, giving those dental exams to
the boss.
Yes, exactly.
It wasn't always like that because right. When we first broached this, I guess it would have been 10, 12 years ago, it was wrong when you're taking work away from, you know, it was there. We were getting a lot of pushback, and I just wondered if they had realized that it was to their benefit to have these folks trained and incorporated in their field.
Exactly, and that's what this is they, when they do the cleans, they're under the supervision of a dentist, and it's part of their, you know, training so they can go out and go into the workforce because there is a need for those types of dental technicians, you know, in our local dental industry.
Thank you.
Is there ability, do you have the ability to scale up if you find that demand is more than what you had anticipated? Because I noticed you mentioned you have a good size office, but it's not really big, right? So.
Well, we're just beginning our office in Akron, but yes, we have the ability to do that. Because we're growing right now, we're just growing in Cleveland, growing in Akron. But one of the other things that we're thinking about doing that we had discussed in our plan was utilizing North Hills as a hub, which is done by Metro and some other health centers in the U.S., and looking at schools that are surrounding that school, like looking at Jennings, looking at the elementary schools over there, and utilizing North Hills as a hub. So therefore, it wouldn't mean that you needed to have as many providers. The other approach to it is, which is what Metro does in Cleveland, is having a mobile clinic. The mobile clinic actually moves around to the different high schools. They have their own van with their own medical rooms on that van. And that's how they're able to service a lot of the schools. So
that's a pilot we start and we see where we go, see how it's accepted.
Okay, I want to thank our presenters for coming. I'm glad to hear what we're doing. It's a good opportunity for Akron Public Schools. Actually, we mentioned earlier this year with Superintendent James, we spoke about a situation like this with healthcare being in the area of North Hill because of the transition that it's making with a lot of our students who are coming from abroad. And then, as we noticed about a month ago or so, then we had a little epidemic, well, not epidemic, but a little situation here where a TB scare. So we need these health services and so forth for the population because, as we know, it's not those individuals' faults from that are coming from abroad, but we know that their health care is not as good as ours here in the United States, so it is part of our job to do something like this. So I want to thank the presenters again for coming. Thank you, and we look forward to the partnership with you.
Thank you.
Okay, need approval of meeting minutes.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved to second. Question? Roll call.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Ms. Walsh?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Bravo?
Yes.
Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes.
And Mr. Miller?
Yes.
And
I'll go back to that.
To the chair for recess, or you can call the questions and close the roll call.
Oh, yeah, we don't have one here. We're closing.
We close?
Yeah.
Okay. Make the minutes show.
All right, superintendent's report.
Mr. President, I have before me for your consideration 30 personnel recommendations, and there are several items I'd like to call your attention to on item number 30. We had the death of a current APS employee and philosophy and educational assistant at Bridges and football coach at Garfield. I'd also like to acknowledge the death of Darlene Davis, who passed away March 12th. She was a secretary in student services and for many years, and she retired just 2 years ago. And I regretfully have to report the tragic loss of an Ellet High School student over the weekend. Patricia Powell was a junior who was killed Sunday morning. Her car was disabled on the expressway, and she was hit by another vehicle. Other than that, these recommendations are in proper form, and I move their approval.
Second.
Before we vote, I'd like for us to all, if we don't mind, have a moment of silence for just a moment for these individuals, please. Thank you.
And there's a few things out in the executive session. There's a few things pertaining to that that I'd like to say a few things about, but we'll deal with that later.
Okay. Roll call.
Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes, abstaining from 26 and 27.
Mr. Arnold?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes, abstaining from item 28.
Ms. Walsh?
Yes, abstaining from item 29.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Brown?
Yes, abstaining from items 24 and 25.
Next, Mr. President, I have before me for your consideration 3 motions and 11 resolutions on the consent agenda. I'd also like to note that in item 9 of the consent agenda, the total will remain the same on the paving, but approximately $37,500 will be coming out of Fund 034, which is the COC maintenance fund, because Resnick is a COC and that part of the paving project should be paid for out of those funds. And these recommendations are that are in proper form, and I move their approval. But before the vote, I would like to bring up Mr. Mark Salopek to review the schematic design for Ellet High School.
Okay, good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, I'd like to share with you tonight the presentation that we did with the community on March 7th regarding the Mead Community Learning Center in Ellet. It's proposed as for grades 9 through 12 for 1,260 students. 210 of those students will be for career tech. The building size is about 240,000 square feet. They currently have about 187,000. So it's going to be in a large facility. It's proposed as a self-swing. We're going to build, in fact, we'll show you in the site plan, we're going to build in the back on the baseball field, leave the students in the existing building, And once the new facility is constructed, we would tear down that facility and build the baseball field in place of where it's sitting right now. To get everybody oriented, this is the actually existing conditions. We have Wolf Avenue to the front when you approach the building from the main street. We have Paxton that circles around the back. The existing Allen High School sits right here, fronting on Wolf Avenue. In fact, when we had the community meeting, one of the main questions that we had, would the existing building still face Wolf? Yes, that is the truth. We have the current football stadium off to the bottom here, which we are not gonna touch. You can see with the red line here is the outline of the new building. We're gonna take over their current parking lot and the baseball field. It was also asked, Lisa actually asked to raise the question in our meeting at the joint board was, what would the neighbors to the back see? There's about a 20-foot drop-off as you start here on Paxton and it goes downhill. So there's about a 20-foot hill that aligns the site to the rear. We're gonna provide new access up from Paxton here. But so these residents will probably see very little of the new building.
Sir, I realize, yeah, you're right. It does, there is a steep climb there, but is there a provision that you're gonna, the landscape plan that you have presented, that you're gonna do some kind of landscaping around that back?
Actually, I mean, this is the proposed site plan. As I mentioned, we're gonna leave the football stadium here.
Well, I know, I live there and I know all that. I'm just saying, usually with city, you have they have a landscape plan.
Yes, you know, we've met with planning and there hasn't been a lot of discussion about adding any kind of buffer here. Because looking at the parking, we're aiming it in opposite directions. But when we get further into it, if there's a request to add some buffer there on the hill, I'm sure there would be no problem with that.
Well, I mean, it wouldn't be much more of an expense to those trees that get real tall and bushy along the curve, the perimeter there.
We can look at that.
Yeah.
Nothing on the table right now, but there's nothing that we can't look at.
And also, when you had that meeting March 7th, were we notified about that?
Yeah,
or?
I was there.
Okay. Wow, yeah. That somebody from the board was there.
We had a decent number of residents that showed up. Mm-hmm. We got very few comments. The one comment that I mentioned was that is it still going to face the front street? Besides that, we didn't get a lot of other concerns or questions that anybody had, but we would be happy at any point in time to meet with any residents that are around there and go over the site plan and see if they have any additional concerns. The last thing we want to do is build something, and then somebody also asked a question about acoustics. I don't see that as a major concern. We're going to have some mechanical equipment back to the back, but we're going to have an acoustical consultant look to that to make sure that we don't have any problems with sending noise off to somebody that's not expected.
The baseball field.
Yes.
Now, do we have any Hank Aarons or Lou Mays going to hit that ball anywhere near the building? Because that baseball field is facing that way. So that's far. We got plenty of space for.
That's the whole objective, though.
Up and coming.
Because when those fields hit higher was when we played Little League was to try to hit higher. If you could hit higher, man, you were the man.
I believe that right now with the location that we have and the size of the field that we're at, we're in really good condition. We've met with the baseball coach numerous times. And his one regret is that we're going to lose that field for a period right here while we go into construction. But we could look at a number of other things with him.
The dimensions are equivalent to the same as what we were going to take him. So there's no reduction in size. So if they hit it that far, well, hopefully comprehensive insurance will take care of you. Yeah.
I talked to Sarver, John, and he quite frequently I see him, and he's very pleased with it. But by the time that gets done, I don't know that he'll still be there, but I hope he is.
Quite honestly, we haven't developed the demolition package yet or all the fine tuning on that baseball field, but there's different things that we can look at with him for fence height, you know, where everything's going to go. I mean, there's a lot of work yet to do on that. That'll be one of the latest packages, so it'll be something that we can still meet with him and talk about. Any other questions regarding the site plan?
Can we get a picture of that? I mean, not a 10 by 5, but just a 8 by 11 or something of that rendering, or what do you have there?
We'll send you a copy of this now. Oh, you want just a picture of this?
Just.
Yeah, I'll send it to you.
That right there. Yeah. You could give it to maybe Ruth and have it hand delivered. It would be good.
Now, we always have a concern. I see that's a lot of flat roof. And it's different, look like it's different variations of flat roof. There's no different levels, different heights, looks like.
We're showing a lot of different levels of height.
Well, and technically it's a low slope roof. It's not a flat roof, but to be perfectly frank, we're building this size. The massiveness of trying to put a sloped roof on it, like it's a lot of heating, and that's a lot of expense that would add to the project.
Yeah, I mean, Paul mentioned it, but just, I mean, when you look at the spans here for what this is doing, to do a roof truss from that side to that side is pretty much not feasible. There are sections that we could do, you know, in small areas, and that would work. But a lot of it also played into the building aesthetic. When we met with the community, we've met with the staff, and I'll show you some renderings in a minute. Their preference wasn't a building that duplicated the middle school. So you'll see in a minute that they asked us to go in a different direction because of the high school, older age kids, and they felt like they wanted something that was a little bit more contemporary and progressive.
That's something I didn't ask earlier. Are we doing wells or geothermal at this point, or do we know yet?
No.
We're not going to do geothermal on this project. When you look at the rates out there for utilities, geothermal does not pay back as much as when we looked at earlier buildings, what it did then. This is the first floor plan of the building, the same orientation as what I showed you previously. The main entrance of the building right here with administration. We have the radio and the TV production off to the front here. The media center is off to the end here. You'll see that we have a three-story classroom wing here. As I mentioned, we have a number of programs here for career tech. I'll touch on those briefly. There's culinary in here. We have early education here. And in the back, we have construction trades. We have auto tech. And then we have their program for animal science here. There'll be an animal science run yard out here that goes with that. Off here with early education, we have a play area here that will be fenced in by a brick masonry wall. We have the gymnasiums, locker rooms off to this side, which relate more to the football field. We have performing arts and the music areas here in the center, student dining here, and then the service areas here to the back with the kitchen. Again, I mentioned it's a three-story classroom area. We have special ed off to this side, general classrooms here around the perimeter with a courtyard in the center, which provides natural light into all of the classroom spaces. And then up on the third floor is all of the science areas. One for utilities, ease and access for utilities, a lot of things that vent through the roof, but all the science areas will be up here on the third floor.
Can you go back and explain the collaboration?
Oh yeah, I'm sorry. I missed that a little bit. Yeah, one of the things we've it's kind of a little bit more newer way of 21st century learning, is we're starting to group classrooms around what we call collaboration area. So here you have four classrooms around this open area outside. We also, here we have five classrooms grouped around this collaboration area. In fact, our staff is working on things today. I talked to a bunch of our people. They're gonna go back to the staff and come back with different options for what we can do here and how these four classrooms relate to collaboration. We've done in other projects in other communities where to open up to the collaboration area, these are garage doors, or they're glass walls that open up, or it could be single doors. But the idea is that with these four classrooms, you can have students that want to do individual study, they can move out into here. And we have areas where they can recharge their laptops, they can recharge whatever mobile device they have. You can have two or three students out here with a counselor talking about different things, but it's more of kind of like breakout areas. So we still have a lot of work that we want to do with those, but I think it's a great opportunity for the school and really moving, giving the kids other opportunities for learning.
Where's WAPS there? Is that the dark purple?
That's right, okay. Right over here. Yeah. And you'll see they have their separate entrance out here.
And they have ones.
I'm just being a white.
This is an overall view of the front of the building. We have the main entrance here. All stone and metal and durable materials. The media center, which I showed you before previously, is here. Administration here with a good view of the front entrance. And then here is our music and TV production programs off to this side. This brick is very recognizable. We've used in a number of the facilities. It's actually the red brick that's at the middle school. Although they mentioned they didn't want the similar look of very traditional. They wanted more of a contemporary, aggressive look. I believe still the red brick fits very well in with that. This is a view looking the other way, the main entrance here, the media center, and the administration. And then just a look of the close-up look of the main entry, and then there's glass all across the top, which basically provides clearer story, natural light into the lobby area. I'd like to open it up for if there's any additional questions or any slides that you want us to go back to that we can talk about. I think it'll be a great project for the community. The first thing that we're starting off with, we're going to get ready to bid it right now, is because we're going to be building back in their parking lot, we're going to build a temporary lot up in the front so that there's additional parking there. And there was also a question asked earlier about the adequacy of parking that they have versus what we're going to propose. We're a little bit less than what they have currently, but we've done a number of traffic studies out there. In fact, our staff have went out on nights of major events, and we believe what we're proposing will be adequate for what's there.
Mark, is that in addition to the one, the side one that you're building that's like on the other end of the baseball field, or when you said additional, or that's the additional that you're...
The additional, the one is the one that was off to the left at the top.
Okay.
Right when you drive in.
All right, that's still the same one. Okay, I just want to show what.
So out of curiosity, assuming bids come in good, we don't have to re-engineer, when we start digging? I mean, when's construction start?
We're actually out to bid for the temporary parking lot, or semi-temporary, but it will become permanent parking lot for the, on the side of the building when we take that parking lot out. We'll go out, we're going out in April for an early site package, which will actually start digging, hopefully, around late August, first of September, to start preparing for the building pad. The actual construction of the building will be bid this fall, and with this look to start as soon as the weather breaks in February, March timeframe of next year. And then it'll be a 2-year build cycle. And then following that build, then obviously the abatement demo and the fall.
Was the abatement demo in the figures we had today at...
Those were just for the building itself. The abatement demo would be additional to that, because it's a separate bid item.
We're currently in the design development phase, working on this. I bet we probably have had 70 meetings with the teachers and staff. We go online, I believe the minutes are all on there. We've gotten great response when we're sitting down talking with everybody. But right now, I mean, you're seeing the floor plan, but what they're sitting down with everybody doing is all the technical parts of it. I mean, just if you just look at the radio station and TV production, I mean, there's a tremendous amount of detail that's involved in that. Make sure that we get it right the first time. The career tech, there's a lot of things in there, in those programs that we haven't been to before. We want to understand exactly what they need in their spaces so we get that right. And then I think the teachers have been very engaged in those collaboration areas. So we're going to come back, I believe, in the next 2 weeks with some different options on what they'd like to see there. So it's exciting, but we have a lot of work yet to do, and it's going to be a lot of meetings.
And what's the projected cost?
The OF, the co-funded portion is around $58 million. The additional LFI is somewhere around 12 or 14, so it's $72 to $74 million.
And this is in relationship to Firestone?
Firestone is a little bit bigger. It's about $10 million or more. In fact, it's quite a bit bigger because it's got the middle school and high school.
Yeah, this is a 912. Any other questions?
And of course, no money is available for that football and track.
I'd love if there was.
They're going to do a patch job, about $5,000-$6,000 or something like that, aren't they? Aren't they going to do a patch job? The patch job on the track, about $5,000-$6,000.
We'll make some repairs on the track.
Hi, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we do need a motion a second before we can move on to roll call.
So moved with the amendment.
To the 37.5 and the CLC 5, right? Yep.
No, I'll second.
Okay. Move the second. Any questions? Roll call.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Brava?
Yes.
Mrs. Neesfield?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Arman?
Yep.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Ms. Walsh?
Yes.
And finally, Mr. President, I have before me for your consideration 24 business affairs recommendations. These recommendations are in proper form, and I move their approval.
Yeah, hold on a second. Yeah.
Need a motion in a second?
Okay.
So moved.
Second.
Question?
Yes, just being naive about this, I've tried to educate myself and trying to learn about the... I'm taking all my notes here about the items for St. V, St. Matthews, that sort of stuff. Can you just give me the five cent tour on that?
Right. So in the state of Ohio, for the parochial schools, they're funded through auxiliary services, and it's really pass-through money. So when they buy computers, the money for that comes from the state, but we're like the fiscal agent for that. So we'll process the purchase orders for those, and then those materials go to the school.
Okay, I understood that part, and thank you for explaining that so well. So that's basically all it is in the Akron.
Right, they make their decisions on purchasing the supplies and the equipment that they need. And like I said, our job is just to process those purchases.
What is that? Is there a name for that title? 28 or something? Or is there a name for the program?
I know it's just a pass through, as David was saying. Yeah. It's a pass through. And they tell us what they want. They have their monies there, and we just approve it because we're just the financial institution. Just we're a bigger institution than some of the others.
Right.
Money just comes through.
That's right. Fine.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any other questions? Roll call.
Mr. Barada?
Yes.
Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Ivory?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Ms. Walsh?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes. Superintendent's report?
The only thing I have to share is 2 weeks ago, the interim state superintendent, Dr. Rivera, held a meeting with quite a few superintendents from around the state, and the big topic was the rewrite of No Child Left Behind, which is now Every Student Succeeds Act. And so there's a lot of work that'll be going on in the Department of Education, and hopefully out of it, the local school districts will get some flexibility. So I know all of the state associations from BASA, OASBO, the School Boards Association, are really keeping a keen eye on the work that the department is doing in terms of promulgating rules. Because right now there's no guidance from the U.S. Department of Education in terms of what that big, thick act really is going to mean to us. So there's a lot of work that will be going on around the state with that. So it was a very good meeting, got a lot of good information.
Can I ask a question related to that, Mr. President?
Yes, I'm sorry.
So it's I believe it's open for public comment right now, too, correct? So are we as a district doing anything directly, or is there anything that we can do to support, or is there anything that we can offer by way of public comment?
The only comment through, like, the associations, which they've encouraged people to do, is talk about, you know, the initial, so there were several PowerPoints that the State Department had issued. One of them said Ohio was going to have a plan by June or July of this year, which didn't make any sense. So we were telling them to put the brakes on it. We have to get some initial information from the state in terms of how they're going to approach this, because there's probably six different committees working at ODE, and what all of the associations are, including our Ohio 8 Coalition, are actually doing on our behalf is getting that information. As soon as we have some information in terms of their initial plan, that'll be the time for us to make comments, because right now people are still reading through the law to figure out exactly what it'll mean for each individual district. And the urbans will have some different priorities, I think, from some of the rural and suburban districts, because our needs are a little bit different. So there will be some time for some comment, which I think will happen early this summer. Will be our first opportunity to weigh in on that.
Yes, and that, just to kind of chime in on that, a couple years ago, went to Washington to lobby for public education, and this was due to Dr. McWilliams giving information as to what we want in stating, we need more local input. We talked to Congresswoman Fudge at that time, and terms told us to contact also. She would do what she needed to do up in Washington for us, but also to work with our state representative, which is Mrs. Amelia Sykes. So we've been working closely together with all of them in order to see that hopefully we can get more local insight and say so on what goes on with Akron Public Schools, because we know more about what Akron Public Schools needs than Washington, D.C., or maybe even the state. So that local, the ESSA is something they've developed. And of course, as anything, it's going to take a while, but we'll wait for it, but it make sure that when it does come, and you can follow that too. It's a lot on in the state. A lot of OSBA has a lot of that information. The National School Board Association has it, so it's everywhere, and you can read up on it, some of that if you would like to. So that would be a good something to do to read and see what they're talking about.
I think that's where I was headed. I mean, I know that you know, we belong to several of those associations,
right.
But you know, I hope if there's anything we can do to support whatever you guys would have,
right,
by way of public comment or feedback or whatever, you know, that we as a board do something too. Mm-hmm. So yeah. I'm sure you're on it. Ellen kept nodding at me, so I know you guys are on it. But, you know.
Okay, anything else, Mr. Superintendent?
No, that was it.
Okay, as far as president report, I only have two things. First of all, I want to thank Garfield High School Culinary again. The students did an excellent job. They came here for the
Kenmore.
I'm sorry, Kenmore.
Shrimp and grits.
Kenmore students came in, I'm sorry. And they did a good job of providing the meal for us in our retreat. I mean, when you have shrimp and grits, you know, salads, you have an upscale meal. They did a very good job there. So we want to thank them. And also, again, just thank all the volunteers throughout the city of Akron who work with our students, our schools, to help the students in any possible way they can. And that's something we always want to thank those individuals for doing, but they don't have to do it. This is volunteer, and we want to thank them for doing that. Treasurer's report.
Two quick items tonight. The first one is something you voted on tonight. We call the alternative tax budget. Was in January, and then we had the acceptance of tax rates at this board meeting. And through Finance Committee has asked for a little bit more detail in terms of high level how we approach the budget. Of course, I've wowed them with spreadsheets at the Finance Committee, the way that they love to see them. But the importance of tonight's vote is this is a good check and balance where the Finance Office sends a message through the board to say, here's what we're collecting in all of our outstanding tax levies. We send it to the Summit County Budget Commission, and they do the same exercise. So between now and June, when we look at setting the budget for next fiscal year, this is kind of one of those preceding documents. The second item tonight is on the finance report, the monthly finance report. And on the expense side, if I could just highlight the purchase service line item. I've been talking for the last few months about our purchase service as it relates to community and charter school and tuition. And just a positive note in terms of our finances here, we're seeing a little less money now reconciled from the Ohio Department of Education leaving the district for charter schools, community schools, ECOT schools, and that's represented in that purchase service line item. And what that means is less students ODE is recording for enrollment. That doesn't mean necessarily a decline, but if you remember, this has been an area that's growing at double digits for us. At least from these initial first month estimates, this is slowing down a little bit. So between now and May, the question has been asked if I would detail exactly to what organizations and where those students are going or not going, for that matter. So we'll do that for the five-year forecast. That concludes my report, unless there's questions.
Thank you, sir. Okay.
A little bit of money with the weather is.
Actually, we've done very good on utilities.
That and snow plowing.
Yes, yeah. Snow plowing, yeah.
Knock on wood.
Very good on utilities.
Yeah, we don't have time. I know.
It's not saving money. We're right. Lessening our expenses. It's your like a true account.
So good.
All right. Committee reports, legal, contract, and policy.
We have no report.
Okay, thank you.
Just wait until next week or next meeting.
Finance Committee, Capital Management.
The first item we have presented for a third reading and final and approval is policy 6234, which is new, the district cash balance. So we're looking for a motion for approval.
So moved. Second.
Move to second. Any questions? Roll call.
Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Otterman?
Yes.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Ms. Walsh?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Bravo?
Yes.
Instructional policy.
We still have a little more in Finance Committee. I just wanted to hit the highlights of our last Finance Committee meeting, though. No, it's okay, because we sort of hit on them at our retreat since it immediately followed the Finance Committee. But we're looking, the big thing on our agenda right now, major cost thing on our agenda anyways, is our health insurance renewal. We discussed that briefly at our retreat as well, but we're looking, comparing and contrasting to what private sector pays, what kind of increases they're seeing, and what other public entities within Summit County are paying and what kind of increases they have as well. So that's something that's being closely monitored by our treasurer. Also, we're looking at the board purchasing thresholds and whether that may be too low in today's time or whether it's not. You know, it's still up for debate, I guess, but that's something we're looking at. And Ryan did hit on the budgeting process and how we're looking at that. And for me, it's more of an education process and how it's put together internally as well, learning a bit about that as well. So that's all I have.
Okay. Anything else on business?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Now we can move on to Instructional Policy Student Achievement Committee.
The Instructional Policy and Student Achievement Committee met this afternoon. We would like to highlight two items. First, a third grade guarantee report card. The Ohio Department of Education released the results of third grade guarantee last week. We're pleased to report that we promoted 99.7% of our third grade students on the fourth grade, onto the fourth grade. As you've heard previously from Dr. McWilliams Woods and Ms. Mary Otley Kelly, we retained only four students last year. Our district was highlighted in ODE's statewide report regarding the third grade guarantee in their press release. Congratulations, A, to all of our hardworking and dedicated third grade teachers, including our tutors and special education intervention specialists who work diligently with our students, and B, to Mary Otley Kelly, who happens to be on vacation today, who leads our third grade guarantee work along with her district steering team. And we have before us at our seats a nice colored diagram that shows other key districts and how they improved. And right there, Akron, 99.7% of our students having completed the third grade guarantee. And as was mentioned, there's a press release, and you can go on to ODE's website and see that press release. This diagram, I understand, will be on their website for the year, this year. So we'll have continuous positive reflection as to what we did with our third grade guarantee. We're looking forward to doing the same and even better this year. We know how hard our staff worked to make sure that we were successful in that area.
Thank you.
Then in also in the consent agenda tonight, if you saw item 14, that was the instructional improvement or in-service days. That's what the board approved. We wanted to highlight one of the things that was pointed out to us, and that is that you'll see in the calendar that the ninth grade students attend school a day earlier than the 10th through 12th grade. That allows for supportive transition into high school. They go a whole day before. They get to see where all their classrooms are. They get to have a pep rally. They get to meet with counselors, make sure their schedules are set, and then the 10th through 12th graders are there clogging up the hallways and knowing where they're going. And this year, we're also going to provide individualized approach with all the kindergarten students. They'll have a one-on-one meeting with their teachers in their classrooms. The teachers and students get to get acclimated to each other, to the classroom, to the school, and the teachers will do basic skill screening so they know what the strengths and potential gaps are as soon as the students walk in the door for their official first day. So apparently do we pilot that at a few places, or did we do it last year?
Last
as well?
Year we did it first time.
Okay, first time was last year. We're gonna do that again this year because it was so well received, not just by the students and parents, but by the teachers who felt like they knew their students better. And one thing I meant to highlight during the consent agenda discussion that I didn't was, if you saw item 16, I thought it was kind of interesting. We do have an MOU with the Akron Waterway Renewal Program. And that, considering all of us pay those high sewer bills, it's nice to have something good come out of that that bill. And it'll be to the benefit of our students with an internship program with an MOU in that. So, good stuff.
right now it's not clear.
Okay, any unfinished business?
I just want to just, since we're moving in this direction, we had it from the health department's presentation, and even with the third grade guarantee and with the calendar, we're looking at little bits and pieces of that academy model. We separated, in the process of separating that ninth grade, which then makes it easier in the future, a ninth grade academy, where we can offer a number of things that we saw, superintendent and others that have gone down to Nashville, that we can start putting some of those pieces together and see some of the big picture. We looked at Ella, and you notice the career tech, various areas. So I'm sure Sister Barbara Williams, her mind is already turning as to what can be done in that arena. So as we're talking, I'm just seeing things sort of falling into place. You know, maybe not intentional, but it's being done anyway, so that we can move forward. So I just want to throw that in. That's an observation.
Okay. Thank you. Any more unfinished business? New business?
New business, our retreat has been scheduled.
We're gonna work on that before we leave tonight.
Okay.
Everyone's responded that.
Yeah. Okay. If there's no new business, then we'd like to, pursuant to Ohio Revised Code, we need to go in executive session, and pursuant to Ohio Revised Code Section 121.22G1, I hereby move that we adjourn to executive session for the purpose of considering investigation of charges or complaints against public employee officials, licensed or students in the district, to meet with legal counsel, disputes involving board and or school district, and prepare for negotiation or bargaining sessions with employees concerning compensation and other terms, and consider of the employment. I need a motion to move into executive session.
Second.
So move to second. Roll call.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Ivan?
Yep.
Reverend Walker?
Yes.
Ms. Walsh?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Yes.
Mr. Bravo?
Yes.
Mrs. Mansfield?
Yes.